Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 8th meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2023. Before we begin, can I remind those members using electronic devices to please switch them to silent. This morning we have apologies from Ariane Burgess and Mercedes Villalba. Our first item of business is a decision to take item 5 in private. Are we agreed? Thank you. Our second item of business today is consideration of the draft Alcoholic Beverages, Fruit and Vegetables Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland Regulation 2023. This instrument is subject to the affirmative procedure. And I welcome this morning Marie Goujon, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs and Islands, and her officials for this agenda item are Kevin Matheson, Policy Manager for Food and Drink Industry Growth Team, and James Hamilton, a lawyer. And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks for inviting me to speak about the Alcoholic Beverages, Fruit and Vegetables Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland Regulations 2023. The UK signed a free trade agreement with New Zealand on the 28th of February last year, and during negotiations, the UK had committed to making 3 minor changes to domestic legislation on how wine and other alcoholic drinks are described and marketed. The Scottish Government remains of the view that the best option for the UK as a whole and for Scotland is the one that Scotland voted for, which is remaining in the EU. The Scottish Government's default position is to align with EU law where appropriate and where that's in Scotland's interests. However, as a responsible government, we are required to observe and implement the United Kingdom's international obligations, and this instrument is required to implement the New Zealand Free Trade Agreement. The changes set out in this instrument will bring some flexibilities to how wine and alcoholic drinks can be labelled and marketed. However, it's not going to impact on the practices currently being employed by producers and traders who can continue to label and market as they currently do. The changes allow producers and sellers of wine and alcoholic drinks slightly more flexibility in the information that they choose to include on their labels. And then this instrument will make 3 changes to retained EU law. So first of all, it will allow any wine product to show alcoholic strength to 1 decimal place. So as an example of that, it could be 12.2%, 12.7%. Retained EU law currently limits wine to being labelled to show alcoholic strength to whole or half units. So say either 12% or 12.5%, and that will continue to remain a possibility for wine that's marketed either here or wine that's exported. The concession to label wine to a single decimal place isn't new. This possibility was already extended to Australian wines by the EU in their wine trade agreement with Australia, which the UK retained after exit. This instrument will also introduce a change to rules concerning the labelling of grape varieties for wine marketed in Great Britain. Where more than 1 grape variety is listed on a wine label, this instrument will require that the named varieties must total at least 95% of the content of the wine, and current retained EU legislation requires that to be 100%. The changes will mean that up to 5% of the content may consist of varieties that aren't shown on the label. The changes proposed in this instrument provide businesses marketing and producing wine of multiple grape varieties with the scope to vary the production of a wine to bring an improved consistency and quality. And UK domestic wine producers have warmly welcomed the flexibility that that's going to bring. The regulations will also allow flexibility in how the terms alc or alcohol and vol or volume appear with the numerical alcohol content on both wine and other alcoholic beverages. So current rules require that alc appears before the numerical alcohol content of the drink, with vol after. And this instrument will now also allow the term alc to appear after the numerical alcohol content of the drink. Together, these changes will facilitate that trade between the UK and New Zealand, and the changes may also help smaller producers in both countries who might wish to exploit a niche for their product in that market, but where the size of the order would mean a full label change wouldn't be economically viable. Again, I just want to stress that these changes are optional. We anticipate that many in the industry with established markets in Northern Ireland and or the EU will continue to label and market wine as they currently do to support sales in those markets. The Scottish Scottish Government consented to a GB-wide consultation seeking views from stakeholders in the sector and more widely on the proposal. And the UK wine industry firmly support the changes that are set out in this instrument, as well as welcoming the flexibility that it also provides. So I hope I've been able to say enough to assure you of the need for this instrument. It does represent just one part of the changes being made that will allow for the new free trade agreement with New Zealand to come into force. But in doing so, we've taken the opportunity to give our thriving wine and alcoholic drink sector flexibility that will support them to trade in the future. And finally, the instrument also amends Article 11 of retained EU law regulation EU number 543/2011 to correct a minor error contained in regulation 55 of the Agriculture Retained EU Law and Data Scotland Act 2020, consequential modifications and agricultural products, aquatic, animal health and genetically modified organisms, EU Exit Amendment Regulations 2022. Thank you. And I'm happy to take any questions that the committee might have.
Well done on that title of that regulation. We'll now move to questions. Are you expecting more SSIs of this type to implement trade agreements coming to this committee?
I think that there is the programme, obviously. We've seen the debate in relation to the LCM that took place in the Parliament yesterday. We have this one coming forward, but I'll ask Kevin if we're expecting any more, particularly in this, in relation to the food and drink.
No, I'm not expecting any, but there are trade deals under discussion with Canada, India, Mexico, Israel. So they might filter down, but I've not been given a heads up personally. So.
Yeah. It seems a bit odd that the only... Yeah. SSI that we have to deal with on a trade deal is down to basically labelling and the content of the wine or the grapes that are used. Is this because, for example, we drink Australian wine as well, is that because there's flexibility within the retained EU law or that there was already concessions for Australian wine coming in and there wasn't that concession for New Zealand?
Well, as far as I'm aware, this was something that New Zealand had asked for during the negotiations, and I think primarily to benefit some of the smaller producers that are, I think, could mainly provide for the home market at the moment, but you could see an opportunity there to export to the UK. So, as far as I'm aware, but I don't know if there's anything further you would want to add to that. Oh, sorry, James.
In Australian wine, the EU and Australia... have a trade deal that covers wine, and that trade deal was rolled over by the UK. So that trade deal with both the EU and the UK already provides for some of the flexibilities that we're seeing in this one. So, for example, the ability to label wine to 0.1 of a decimal point. So, so we already see that flexibility with other trade deals that the EU have.
Right.
Yeah, and I would just point out as well that I think the EU in their negotiations with New Zealand as well are also looking at similar changes where there are actually greater flexibilities. As an example, the percentage of the grape varieties that should be on the label too.
Okay. So one of the main reasons is there was existing legislation that dealt with this because there was an EU deal with Australia, but those regulations didn't exist within a New Zealand EU. Legislation, okay, I get that now.
So that the EU labelling regulations provide for exemptions for trade deals that the EU's done with other countries. So some of those are already incorporated, and then and the Australia one in particular has been rolled into the UK agreement with Australia. So this is potentially an outlier that New Zealand didn't have a trade deal, and this is just to give them the flexibility they'd asked for.
Okay.
And the deal they've negotiated with the EU has the same flexibilities, which is going through the EU ratification process at the moment.
Thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
I think you've kind of answered it really, but it's about the flexibility. I was going to ask you whether within the free trade deal, it's one way of ensuring that New Zealand can export multiple grape varieties, which they probably don't do now. The main varieties are probably Pinot Noir, Merlot, Sauvignon. You know, we have a great taste for that here in the UK. But the alcohol content as well. I presume it's, as you say, to give them flexibility. But within a free trade agreement, surely it's also to remove the burden and help with the labelling to allow greater choice, which allows the flexibility. I presume that just makes a great free trade deal, and that's one of the negotiations that they had. And also weather as well. It might be dependent on weather with regards to the grape variety and the alcohol content.
Yeah, and just say, I think it also provides, I mean, I think in particularly provides more clarity and transparency, mm-hmm. which has been welcomed by the lower alcohol volume producers too, mm-hmm. in terms of, you know, the percentage points or the level of alcohol which is within that as well. And that's certainly a point that they've welcomed within mm-hmm. that. And there can be other varieties that are used to help with the consistency of the wine product. But again, it's been something that's been welcomed by producers on both sides. Mm,
good.
Other questions? No. OK, we now move on to our third agenda item, which is the formal consideration of the motion to approve the instrument. And I invite Mary Gujan to move motion S6M-07704 that the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee recommends that the Alcoholic Beverages, Fruit and Vegetables Miscellaneous Amendments Scotland Regulation 2023 draft be approved.
Formally moved, Convener.
Thank you. Does any member wish to debate the motion? No. Is the committee content to recommend approval of this instrument? Yes. And finally, is the committee content to delegate authority to me to sign off our report on our deliberations on this affirmative SSI? Thank you. That completes consideration of the affirmative instrument. And I thank the Minister and officials for attending today. We'll suspend briefly to allow a change in witnesses. Thank you. Our next item of business this morning is the pre-legislative scrutiny of Scotland's future agricultural policy. Our evidence session today will focus on biodiversity issues and we'll be taking evidence from Nature Scot. And I welcome remotely to the meeting Ross Lilly, Head of Natural Resource Management, and his colleague Professor Des Thompson, Principal Advisor on Biodiversity and Science. As normal, could you please type R into the chat box if you request to speak? Given there's only two, that shouldn't be too difficult. We've got approximately 60 minutes of questioning this morning. So I would like to thank you for joining us. And I'm going to kick off with a very broad question. What I would like you to give us an indication of the drivers of biodiversity loss within agriculture and to consider what changes have driven that loss historically and also consider the practices that have led to the decline or maintaining the pressure on biodiversity today. So we'll kick off with Ross.
Thanks. But actually, can I maybe refer that to a colleague to answer that particular question?
Okay. Yes. That's fine.
Sure. Thank you very much, and good morning. And thank you for the question. Agricultural intensification is really one of five principal drivers of biodiversity loss, not just globally, but in Scotland. And to answer your question very directly, it's really the intensification of agriculture that's putting very considerable pressure on biodiversity. And it's agricultural intensification in terms of reducing the amount of space for nature, and in terms of timing, reducing the time available, especially for farmland birds to breed successfully. But overall, it's this intensification on space and in terms of timing.
Can I ask, so I should declare an interest as a former farmer. And 20, 25 years ago, there were schemes which helped farmers fence off watercourses, increase field margins, fence off wet areas, rebuild dikes, stop and cutting grass till later in the season. Methods of cutting grass, so starting in the middle of the field rather than the outsides and work your way in and so on. Why have those interventions not seen a halt in the decline or a slowdown in the decline? Why are we still seeing a rapid and, very concerning decline in biodiversity?
It's really the scale of the changes you're describing there. I mean, the changes in watercourse management, introducing field margins, are very helpful in terms of sustaining some bird life. But if you sit back and think about some of the farmland birds like lapwing, oyster catcher, corn bunting, skylarks, they need very large areas of farmland in order to breed successfully. The sort of small piecemeal efforts to improve farmland are not going to help biodiversity as a whole. And the awful thing now is that we have this very extensive database showing that we've lost so many of our farmland birds, we've lost so many of our pollinators, because we've not been able to transform agricultural at a sufficiently large scale to benefit many of these birds. I mean, one example I'll give you for skylarks and with the production of silage. Very often, the sort of repeated cutting of silage is simply not providing space and time for skylarks to build nests, to lay eggs, and then to rear chicks successfully.
So what you're saying is, for the last 20 years, farmers have been encouraged to undertake certain activities in a certain way, but you're in effect saying today it's been a waste of time because it wasn't done on the scale that it should have been. And when did you realise that was the case, and why wasn't more done sooner?
I think, first of all, I'd say that the farmers, more than anyone else, realise the plight of biodiversity. You are a farmer. I know many farmers and talk with them, of course. And I mean, many of them are heartbroken at seeing the changes. You know, birds like lapwings, you know, in rural areas, these are red-listed birds now. And these declines have been charted since the 70s, and especially since the 1990s. And now we have a biodiversity crisis now. I mean, governments, not just in Scotland, but globally, have referenced the climate and the nature emergency. So now we've got the courage and the conviction to say, actually, this has to stop. We need to transform the way we manage the land in order to halt the loss of body.
Thank you. Ross, would you like to come in?
Yeah, I think we've had 50-odd years of the Common Agricultural Policy. It has been a very effective European policy that's been applied in the UK, in that it's driven and supported farmers being ever more efficient and effective food producers. Really, that was the fundamental purpose of the Common Agricultural Policy,
in latter years, it brought in other public outputs, outcomes that it's sought to achieve, but in a very compartmentalised approach. On one hand, the main driver's support is to make sure farmers are resilient and have income supported for food production. On the other hand, they're asked to put land aside for nature and for other public interests, access and what have you. That in our current climate clearly is not going to continue to work. It's not a system that will tip farming up to deliver the multiple public outcomes that we need from them. It's forcing them to make the fact that it makes in each aspect, it makes it less resilient. So in a food production point of view, particularly with the changing climate that we have now, let alone future climate change, the systems that farmers are resistant as they used to be in terms of food production. And if that was combined with managing land for nature or using nature systems, then it would not only make food production more resilient, but also deliver that biodiversity loss that we've, restore that biodiversity loss that we've had over the last few years.
Thank you. I've got a question from Jim Fail and then Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, convener. I'd like to go back to the point that you just made about intensification, Ross, if that's okay. We're talking about whole farming approach here, as in across the industry, but two farms have got different climates and different biodiversity challenges. A farm has different climate and biodiversity challenges, let alone a whole-scale system. So I'm going to talk predominantly about semi-upland, upland and hill farming. If intensification is part of the issue around loss of biodiversity, you can't get more landscape farming than hill and semi-upland and upland farming. So why are we seeing the same drop in numbers in upland farms as we are in the intensively producing the big arable producing farms? Why is that?
Of course, a lot of the upland farm habitats there, and species that depend on them are far more sensitive than elsewhere. And so even a small change in farming intensification can have an impact on that habitat. You're right, it's not. In some cases, we've seen quite a significant drop in sheep numbers, for instance, on some hill. Farm support's been changed. In other areas, we still have quite high livestock densities, which, from a point of view of types of habitat restoration that we need to see in the uplands, for climate as well as biodiversity, like woodland regeneration, peatland restoration, they are still too high, those numbers. But it doesn't mean to say that there isn't a sustainable form of uphill livestock management, because what we don't want to see is abandonment of uphill ground with livestock, because livestock are a fundamental need to keep habitats open and diverse. So there's a sweet spot there.
Okay, I'm glad to hear you saying that we don't want to see no livestock, because I also have to declare an interest. I've been a hill and sheep and cattle farmer and shepherd for 30 years. So has there been any consideration given to predation on these ground nesting birds? Because my own experience is that with a huge influx of ravens, literally every lapwing, curlew, redshank, golden plover, I used to have to actually mark where the nests were as I drove around my lambing fields. By the time I came out of it, with the explosion in raven numbers, there was literally no point because there were no nests full. So has there been any consideration given to what predation has done? Because I know the RSPB would deny that, but my own anecdotal witnessing was that it was a huge effect.
Yes, do you want to answer that one?
Yes, so your observation is spot on in terms of predation, and there's very considerable work being done on waders at the moment, in particular working for waders. And there's a number of pressures on waders, such as golden plover, lapwing, redshank, snipe. There's loss of heather, fragmentation of upland landscapes, especially piecemeal forestry. Just very small areas of forestry will encourage nesting by crows, for instance, And from just one or two tiny stands of forestry, whole populations of lapwings can be wiped out by crows and indeed foxes. In terms of the science, the science is pointing to ravens not being such a problem as crows and foxes. So it varies very considerably from area to area. But coming back to your original observation, it's really the fragmentation of the upland landscape which is encouraging predation, but also encouraging in some areas trampling of nests by deer, and in a very few areas by sheep.
Does that not absolutely highlight the complexity of this? Because what we're trying to do is get farmers to buy into to woodland creation, to have timber as part of their ability to make a living off the land, and yet that in itself will actually contribute to wading birds' number decreasing, because if we're going to do it properly, you don't want whole-scale hill planting. You want to do it in stands that will be shelter belts and create environments for wildlife, and yet that same environment is then going to create a nesting ground or a breeding ground for predators that are going to wipe out the ground nesters.
Yes, I mean you're describing very neatly what may happen, and so in relation to forestry, it's absolutely vital that we have resourcing of predator control. That is so important. In many areas where we've lost lapwings, the only change we've seen in the landscape is a couple of shelter belts being produced, and on the face of it, these appear perfectly innocuous. And are often very well managed, but they're providing cover for predators such as crows and foxes. And so just finding a way of managing predation in these areas and providing suitable support would make a great difference. Deer are another issue in some of these areas where there are very small plantings, that's providing cover for deer. And of course, even in the lowlands, never mind the uplands, we've seen this marked increase in deer. So again, we need to have sufficient resourcing for deer control.
Thank you, Convener.
Rachel Hamilton.
Morning, and thank you for being here. I just want to make the point that on the 13th of May 2022, I visited a grouse moor in my constituency, which is Ettrick, Roxburgh, Berwickshire. And they practice, manage Muirburn. They have an active grouse moor, and below it is a farmer who has a lowland farm of mixed livestock enterprise. On that day, and I'm going to read to you what I saw: lapwing, oyster catcher, curlew, golden plover, snipe, heron, red-leg partridge, black grouse, red grouse, corvids, meadow pipit, and windchat. I have never seen such a diverse amount of biodiversity in my entire life, and it was a fabulous experience. I think that proved to me that a managed farm, you know, a decent stocking density and the rest of it, including the managed upland, was really working. And I just wanted to make that point. But my question really is on where this biodiversity loss is occurring. Are we calculating biodiversity loss across Scotland and the islands, including marine, when we talk about these things, or do we specifically talk about agriculture when you cite intensification? If you look at the decline of the curlew of 60%, it's twice the rate of England. So why is that so if we have similar agricultural practices? And is the AIC scheme reversing biodiversity loss?
Who would like to go for that one first?
So first of all, thank you very much for that observation, because that's exactly what I see in a number of grouse moors and other hill farms that are very well managed. Especially for the waders such as curlew. It's just such a joy to see curlew and lapwing in these areas. You're contrasting England with Scotland. One fundamental difference is that we have more forestry plantings in Scotland. And I come back to my argument about crow and fox predation in particular associated with these areas. So had you visited grouse moors in England, in the north of England, you would have noted first much more extensive tracts of grouse moor, but also much less forestry, and therefore a much less risk of predation for the nesting waders. So I think that's one observation I'd make. Mm. The other rather harsh observation I'd make, just on these birds you've mentioned, in Scotland, since 1994, we've lost 50% of our kestrel, lapwing, greenfinch population, 50% of our oyster catcher and rook population. I mean, rooks, for heaven's sake, when you think of how common they are, we've seen a halving of the population. So across the board, across the sort of Scottish landscape, we are witnessing these really awful losses. And that brings into sharp focus then those areas you visit that are extremely well managed and where we're managing to sustain these wonderful bird and pollinator populations.
Professor Thompson, is it geographic? And is it taken as a whole when calculating?
We're very fortunate because of the work by the British Trust for Ornithology and RSPB, we can provide regional statistics. So we can contrast the northeast of Scotland with the southwest of Scotland. We can contrast the islands with the mainland. So, and there are sort of very marked regional differences. So, for instance, in parts of northeast Scotland, we're seeing some very worrying trends in declines of upland waders. But even there, where we've got good management in place, we've got thriving populations. If I might just sort of home in on one area and one bird we're extremely concerned about, and that's in the Western Isles, the cornbunting. I mean, cornbunting is an absolutely marvellous bird. It's got a fascinating life cycle. It's one of the latest breeders we've got. And we've only got 1,000 stinging males now. And in the Western Isles, we had a healthy population. But the chances are we're going to lose the cornbunting from the Western Isles. Cornbunting in the Western Isles has got such specialised habits that it's now viewed as a subspecies, globally important. So you've got an outlier population in the Western Isles, and unless we have active intervention and put some straightforward measures in place to improve the overwinter food supply, to look after the nesting habitat that's so important for these birds, we will lose the cornbunting from that wonderful area of Scotland. Now, I highlight the cornbunting because it's got this very distinctive song. I mean, it, as a breeding bird, it's fascinating. It's a male that can have up to 7 or 8 females in its nesting territory. The birds vary very considerably in their productivity. But if you go back to the 30s and 40s, virtually every rural rail station you went to catch your train in the morning, you would hear cornbunting singing. Now, I doubt that there are more than 5 rural rail stations in Scotland where you would hear these wonderful birds singing. And that just brings into sharp focus the awful loss of biodiversity we're witnessing at the moment. And in each part of Scotland, we can point to small stories like that, where we know what's causing the decline. And so we need to try and put in place adequate resourcing. And to come back to an earlier point made about farmers, farmers, more than anyone else, are witnessing these changes and decrying these changes. So they're the people who need the support here to recover our biodiversity.
Can I ask Ross about the eggs?
Ross. Yeah, Ross, could you come in?
Yeah, so eggs has been an exceptionally good scheme in terms of what it does do is it provides the deep and narrow support farmers need. So that's the specific support for a particular measure, but very prescriptive. And because of its limited nature in terms of funding, it's only a small part of the past Common Agricultural Policy series of schemes. It means that it can only be applied in very small areas of the farm in general. What is required for a lot of these species is that you need that broad brush, that scale that has mentioned about. Going on to talking about the future agriculture reform and what the programme needs to do is to try and build in the broad and shallow measures that farmers would like to do and take up and can adopt that complements those very specific habitat measures that the EEC scheme currently supports.
Thank you. We will get over this section, which is all about the devastating loss, and look at some of the important solutions. But just before we move on, right now, given the pressures on land price, and we do have pressures on land, and a cap has driven farmers to try and get as much out of the land that they own. And right now, given the cost of land, many farmers are trying to improve the land that they have, which is seeing in many parts, and particularly in Dumfries and Galloway, where we're seeing hedgerows being pulled out, we're seeing nows being taken off, field flattening at a level which we've never ever seen before. You know, I'm not blaming farmers, they have to maximise their output from the land they've got. But who is responsible for ensuring compliance? So is it the planning department? Is it SEPA? Is it Nature Scot? Nobody appears to take any responsibility when it comes to compliance, where there's questions over whether rocky knives, which are unimproved, would require an EIA before being removed, whether fields that haven't been ploughed for decades or even more, do they revert to unimproved? In which case, there should be regulations right now in place which would prevent that type of land clearance happening. So who's responsible, and what are Nature Scot doing to make sure right now, right this very minute, there's not a bulldozer in the field destroying a habitat for forever?
Well, essentially that is mostly regulated through payments, agriculture payments. So if the farmer is a claimant of basic payment, then the Good Agricultural Environment Condition should cover those aspects, which obviously then comes within the realms of ARFID and their inspections and such things. That's largely where it lies. If it sits within a protected area, a site, special scientific interest, then obviously Nature Scot has a role in terms of enforcing the minimum ground conditions for a SSSI.
Do you any enforcement? Have you any examples of where you actually have gone in and said, wait a minute, this is unimproved land, this hasn't been ploughed before, you need an EIA? Have you done that? Any examples of it working with?
Within the EIA process, obviously ARPID have picked up a number of cases in the past about improvements of permanent pasture, which is a gate condition. And within SSSIs, we have used the Nature Conservation Act to enforce SSSI conditions here.
Okay, thank you. Hopefully moving on to something more positive, Alistair Allen.
Thank you. I will certainly do my best on that. I agree, Convener. We have heard a lot about the problems just now, and I'm keen to hear a bit about whether there are existing solutions that we can build on to some extent. As I am prone, going to mention the word crofting here, but there are mown grassland schemes, there are forms of less intensive agriculture out there that are helpful to species, ground nesting birds. And I just wonder which of these schemes can we build on in the future? I'm thinking of, again, like you, thinking of, you mentioned corn bunting, but corn crake, I can, although I represent the Western Isles, so I can recognise what you're saying. My origins are in the borders, and my father can remember on a farm in Berwickshire being kept awake at night, or he could remember being kept awake routinely by corn crakes. So there has been huge change, but what are the forms of agriculture and the forms of agricultural support that we should be building on?
If I can answer that. So first of all, we recognise crofting is a really good system that produces multiple outcomes for the public. But you know, it's a way of life, a way of farming that's not just about food production, it's all the other things that you mentioned there. So as a model to follow, we want to continue supporting crofting, absolutely, or that crofting style of management. I think one of the issues that we've had in terms of the way farming has been supported through the CAP, as I said before, is the fact that there hasn't been the chance for the individual who is most best placed to join up the dots, join up the management to make it best use for the multiple outcomes that public are now looking from farming. And that is the farmer and the crofter. Because the way that schemes have been run and developed is that you chase each one in individually, and the integration happens at national policy scale in terms of what's prescribed and what is measured and what is
incentivised rather than at the croft or the farm scale. So a future model or a way of supporting that type of farming is to try and delegate the responsibility for joining the dots, joining the funds, making the funds work best, public support best for the individual farm in the circumstance that they're in. And you know, an example of where that was working quite well from a point of view of crofting was the ESA scheme, the Environmental Sensitive Area Scheme, which was back in the 90s, early 2000s, where there was a clear prioritisation exercise around a particularly distinctive biogeographical region, and there was one ESA area, for as you'll know, for the macro regions of Western Isles, the Emerald Islands, which articulated what were the particular priorities for that area. Concrete, macro cropping was the key priorities for the Western Isles ESA. And it gave the crofter the reassurance that if they entered into that scheme, they could take measures that were relevant to them, and we're going to deliver the biodiversity interests and farming interests within that particular area, as opposed to another ESA potentially in the borders where hedgerows, for instance, was probably the priority and not relevant to Western Isles. So that way of regionalising, making it, putting more power in the hands of the crofter and the farmer to actually make the funds work for them in their circumstances is where we want to go.
Thank you. Now move on to a question from Rachel Hamilton.
I've asked my question on that specific section.
Okay. Beatrice, you had potentially a supplementary on...
Yeah, no, I think it's been answered, actually.
Jenny?
Mine have been answered as well. I represent Argyll and Bute, so I was very interested there to hear about the regionalisation and making it fit for purpose for the different types of farming. If it's okay, convener, will I just move on to...
There is one question on data collection.
Oh, there is data collection. My apologies. We're wondering if there are any gaps in data collection, if it is consistent data collection across all of Scotland, or if there are specific areas that perhaps you need additional information, and how can that be achieved?
I can kick off that, and maybe Chris can come in later. So what we don't have is comprehensive, detailed land-based data as to what the condition of our natural assets are. We have various attempts at that. The Macaulay Land Use Institute, JHI, James Hutton Institute, as they are now, have various attempts to measure habitats. We've done that within Nature Scot as well, but actually we need it down to the level of the individual field and the habitat level that potentially only the farmer really is aware of. So one way that we can capture that is, there are various satellite-based technology that you can get better data that government could generate and put in the hands of the farmers, so they have better understanding of where they are sitting in their performance. But the farmer themselves can do that through what we're hoping to build, which is a biodiversity audit approach, a tool for them to have the data in their hands in the form of an app. And actually record what they're doing and how effective that's been. That would certainly help fill the gap in some of the data that we're missing.
Okay, thanks, Ross. That's really helpful. I'm just thinking the farmers are being asked to fill in a lot of different reports, whether it's a carbon audit one, their land use, and now this as well. Is there any way of pulling these different systems together?
Well, I think, certainly encouraged by how other states, member states within the UK are tackling this issue, and particularly Wales and Northern Ireland are exploring and have developed the use of LIDAR technology to get digital, very accurate digital data as to what the habitat vegetation condition is, largely from a climate perspective, because it helps understand where the emissions balance are and sequestration is in those countries. I understand that there's an interest in that and having that in Scotland. It certainly would provide the kind of base layer data that actually everybody would draw from, whether you're doing a carbon audit or you're doing a biodiversity audit, the same type of data.
Okay, thank you.
It's a very thank you. It's a very brief question to yourself, Ross. You're saying that the government doesn't have the level of data, but as a farmer, I used to have a crop plan every year and knew what was going on in every single field and what I was going to do in that field based on the soil analysis I had done, what I was looking to do, what I was looking to achieve. Is there not a way of yourselves or the data gatherers to be able to actually speak to the farming community? Because if we're looking for that field level data, then a vast amount of that data is already available. We just have to tap into it and speak to the farmers to get it.
Absolutely. I totally agree. And I think what's been lacking, perhaps, is the tools available to make it easy for the farmer to share that data and for government to collate it in a way that allows us to understand what's going on. And I think with the modern development of technology and app-based data handling tools, and I know many farmers are engaging in those, particularly like the dairy industry and so on, and recording what they are doing with crops and milk yields and so on, that the tools are now able to make that easier in a way that's never been before. And I think behind that, certainly what government certainly currently has is the LIPIS system, the Land Parcel Information System, which farmers declare data from through their staff forms every year. That's a huge resource that we can build upon. There's a lot of data within that that's already accessible to the farmer and to ourselves and government that we can use as a baseline.
Thank you.
Just carrying on from that, you're talking about apps and collecting data, and we were due to have Dieter Helm, who is regarded as a kind of leading expert in looking at natural capital and biodiversity, whatever. Unfortunately, he's not able to join us today. But we've heard about farmers being asked to soil test. We've heard about farmers having carbon audits. But last night in the Farming for 1.5, we heard that one of the biggest problems is there is not a destination. Farmers don't know why they're doing this and what ultimately the outcomes are to be. So are we a bit like that with biodiversity? So, as I say, we used to have FWAG groups, Farming Wildlife Action Groups, where we'd officers come out, help farmers put together their plans to restore waterways, build dikes, improve habitats. And those officers work with farmers to see what improvements have been made. That we've lost that over the last 15, 20 years. Do we need more people on the ground from Nature Scot to work with farmers to look at what they need to do, but also record the positive outcomes? Because that appears to be what's lacking just now. And just you talked about that. What are the timescales for that? You know, we're in a crisis. There's lots of talk about everything's very slow and things are delayed. When can we get the app? When can we get farmers actually realising the benefits that they are delivering from the actions they're taking?
So we've got about 19,000 regular claimants with public support, farmers, grotters. That's quite a big population of people to engage with on a one-to-one basis. And at any one time, EEG scheme, for instance, supports about 3,000 of farmers in their contract, of which they've received some support and advice from particularly likes of SRUC and others. And what we need to do is get to a point where every farmer and crofter has a learned individual, and we know from a lot of the work we've been doing in Nature Scot on the Farming with Nature programme that we've been developing, that a lot of farmers and crofters take their advice and their guidance from peer to peer first and foremost, particularly within the family and their neighbours, before they go to their formal advisor, quite often it's the industry, and then probably for the bottom of the pile is a government like ourselves. But clearly, to get the shift in wholesale land use that we're looking for climate agenda and for the biodiversity agenda, we need every farmer crofter to have some form of support and help in terms of advice and guidance in a way that's affordable. And that has to be through a combination of peer-to-peer support, the advisory industry that's out there being scaled up and able to scale up their support, and indeed from ourselves within Nature Scot, and within a lot of the expertise is also within ARPID, our cultural offices as well. CEPR too is in that game. And we need a common kind of understanding about what are the key drivers and
that it will not happen overnight, because to reach 19,000 will take a number of years. But you're starting with some of the tools, like the biodiversity app we're trying to develop. It can, in the simplest way as possible, people can start to have a go themselves, and over time build in the advice and support they need, given that everybody's starting from different points. Some farmers will have to do it themselves, and got the wherewithal, others will need more support.
Okay, thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
Yeah, I just wondered on this point, the James Hutton Institute did some work on the increase in biodiversity from actions. So where there was woodland and scrub, there was an increased number of biodiversity species. However, there was a loss of, for example, meadow pipit and merlin. How do you prioritise species one over another from the actions proposed by the government? And do you have any modelling on loss and gain?
Yes, so if I can come into this first, I mean, this is a real challenge. We're fortunate both James Hutton Institute and the SRUC have excellent data here, and it's really important here to set priorities at the regional level. And the example you're giving there for Northeast Scotland, I mean, there where we've got some internationally important heathlands, if we have forestation and woodland regeneration there, we'll actually lose habitats that are internationally important. Whereas if you go to areas in the West Scotland, some of the West Highlands there, we have a dearth of species-rich woodland. And so having woodland regeneration there at the expense of wet heaths that in some areas have fortunate to have meadowpipit, but not much else, then actually sort of moving the landscape in that direction is very good. So we're within the sort of newly published draft Scottish Biodiversity Strategy, we've been reflecting on the regional variation and the importance of biodiversity in different areas, but also thinking then about the different levers we need to pull in order to maximise the biodiversity benefits. And if I may just comment on, related to that, what we've just been discussing about clusters of farmers or crofters working together. Having one person, one advisor, interacting with a group of crofters or a group of farmers and providing advice on biodiversity audit, providing advice on how biodiversity is changing and therefore how you can tweak practices, that can make a massive difference for biodiversity. And one example, if I may, I'd give is just the Farmland Bird Lifeline that's been operating again for corn buntings in northeast Scotland. I mean, we got to a situation there where we'd seen an 83% decline in corn buntings, but as a result of concerted efforts by 53 farmers putting in place some very simple farmland measures, we've managed to halt the loss of corn buntings to the extent that where we're getting active management and cooperation, we're getting a 5% per annum increase in corn bunting numbers. So having targeted measures and having cooperation between whether it's crofters in the West, farmers in parts of the East, makes a world of difference.
Thank you. We're now going to move on to more detailed scrutiny of the forthcoming Agribill. Jenny Minto.
I'm interested to hear what your or Nature Scots' input has been into the development of the tiered route map. And I'm thinking of ones that specifically impact on the West Coast of Scotland, where my constituency is. So I'm thinking about the LFAS payments, if you've been involved in discussions around that. And if I can also slightly go off at a tangent, the geese payments as well that Nature Scot manage.
So far, we've been engaged in what is currently termed the Tier 2 and to some extent the Tier 3 elements of the four-tier approach. But our interest lies in all four tiers, and what we've been providing is advising the kind of things we've just been talking about, and that in order for farmers and crofters to deliver across the biodiversity and climate agenda, all four tiers need to play their part in the support.
So starting from base tier, the way that the regulatory baseline is set in good agricultural environment condition and cost compliance measures need to reflect the kind of baseline that, farmers need to be at, not only from a point of view of good farming and good agricultural condition, but from a good environment condition perspective. And it can do its part to making sure that the baseline, you know, that the point made there by convener, that we stop any further damage to important habitats. And then tier two, the enhanced conditionality, where we've had most input in recent years, is about developing the broad and shallow measures that can be supported by that that proposal for 50% of the basic payment to be based on conditionality. We've designed those climate environment measures. The tier three, obviously, the later tiers where EECS has been started and where we're looking now, thinking about how the measures that EECS has been particularly targeting could fit into that elective tier. And then tier four, as we understand it, is where the advice and the knowledge transfer and those aspects that about helping farmers build up their professional capacity to transition is important. So all four tiers work that way. We're involved in the Farm Advisory Service steering group and making sure that what it's currently doing in tier four is supporting it. The point you make about LFAS, there is a different, there's a cross-cutting issue across the four tiers, which is how payments are distributed. We haven't had a lot involved in that, but obviously we're very interested to support the thinking around which element, how much funding is required in each tier in order to bring it, to make sure that tier does its part to play. And I mean, particularly for LFAS, then it's a way of so far being supplementing the income of disadvantaged farmers and working in environmentally disadvantaged areas. And there's a logic there that could be turned around and saying, well, these farmers are also in areas sitting on some of our most carbon-rich stores in terms of peatland and woodlands, and have the greatest potential, in fact, to deliver both the carbon sequestration aspect of that and the biodiversity elements that these habitats support. And there could be a good argument for saying, well, in return for receiving that additional support that LFAS has traditionally provided, it could be that that's the justification for support in those areas.
Yeah, I think that's an interesting way of looking at it and turning around to say that actually these aren't less favourable areas. They are actually areas that are able to create great biodiversity and also the carbon sequestration. And I also think the other important thing is the sustainability of the rural population, which I think has to be built into the thoughts around this as well. And if I may, if the convener doesn't stop me, to ask specifically about the geese payments and where you see these fitting in to the tiers.
So there's no doubt about it. The farmers are having to support an additional burden of supporting protected, you know, globally important goose populations, particularly those in Islay, need dedicated support. I mean, there's certainly the habitat elements of what they're doing, grassland management, for instance. There's certainly if those livestock farmers and elsewhere with geese are going to have to adopt more resilient, more regenerative type grazing systems, grasslands that are more robust and able to, more permanent, more legume content, everything else, there's an opportunity there potentially for that to be less attractive to geese. And coupled with more land put aside for nature, for wildlife, where geese roost and where their natural habitat is, it would take the pressure off, certainly, in some of these more conflicts and situations between geese and grassland. Coupled with the scare support and the additional, the licence support that Nature Scot provides, it needs all those aspects to work together. And that's what we can try and build through agriculture reform and the evolution of the schemes that Nature Scot have been running up to now.
Okay. Thank you, Ross. And if I may, just one very quick question. We've focused on trying to maintain different bird species across Scotland. Also, some thoughts on plants as well. I'm aware that there's rare orchids, for example, in my constituency, and then also the impact that that has on insects, the marsh flotilla, for example.
Yeah, I mean, the reason why we've still got good marsh flotilla populations in Argyll and we've got Irish lady stresses on Hollandsey and Ireland and so on, largely because we've got very low intensive cattle-based farming systems. So what we must try and do is in the drive to make livestock more efficient for things for emissions and the issues around livestock support is that it still allows or still supports farmers keeping low intensive, particularly cattle management, because generally they are good habitat managers. And you know that those diverse habitats on the edges of woodlands and wetlands in Argyll and the West Highlands is a good example of that.
Thank you.
I think he's answered the point you were. Yep. Do you want to ask Jim?
Thank you, Camille. I want to just pursue that bit a little bit further, Ross, because as someone who used to graze hill cattle, I am absolutely in favour of making sure we've got coos in the hill. But if the LFA support, and as somebody who used to get LFA support, I would have much rather seen much bigger payments. Let me put that on the record. If the LFA support is to be increased to have low-intensity cattle numbers, this is probably not your remit, but is there any consideration to maintaining critical mass so that we've got the numbers of calves to keep the industry working? And it's a question I keep on asking, but it's one that keeps on getting skipped over, because the one can't survive without the other.
I think one opportunity to try and make sure that critical mass is there in terms of keeping the infrastructure around about cattle grazing in the hills alive is for farms to cooperate. So if we build in support for cooperation, not just for doing specific biodiversity measures like Des mentioned earlier about corn planting, but also to make a group of farmers work together to ensure that the outcomes they're trying to achieve, albeit in this circumstance using cattle, is all work together. So they're allowed to apply the scheme and support in a way that works for all of them, not just as individuals. But it's for them to lead that process. And what we need to do, make sure, is that the system of support across the four tiers gives them maximum opportunity to do that. That's a starting point. Obviously, then after that, it's about the funding levels within those individual schemes.
Okay, thank you.
Just on a couple of questions. It touched on cattle. Nature Scot did come under a lot of criticism for removing cattle off one of their farms in Galloway recently. It'd be interesting to find out what the biodiversity count is now on that hill in the Cairnsmore of Fleet. But my question specifically around the tier system again and baselining. So we want to see improvements in biodiversity, and in some ways farmers should be rewarded for that. What's your views on how we baseline where we start? So we'll have some farmers who have planted hedgerows, will have sacrificed some productive land to improve biodiversity, and we'll have other farms where it's a biodiversity desert. Do you give more farm money to those to reverse the deserts and just allow the farmers who've done the right thing for 20, 30, 40 years just to continue? And, that might have an implication on capping, where a big productive farm gets high payments because of its output, but also requires a big level of input to reverse or address its biodiversity loss, if you like. So how do you view capping and how we baseline farms that have done the right thing for generations and those who are maybe been less kind to biodiversity?
I I would answer that actually those farms likely to have done less for biodiversity are the ones that are most productive agricultural areas where they can afford to have maximised their food production of that. And as a result, what was there in terms of biodiversity has suffered. And I would argue that in the mainstream farm support, in terms of the main measures, farmers just adopting more regenerative agricultural systems in those areas could do so much more for biodiversity just by that alone before they are paid to set aside ground. But obviously, we need both. But there's a heavy lifting can be done through regenerative agriculture support rather than necessarily direct biodiversity support in some of those areas. Whilst those that have already delivered and already managing high nature value habitats, what we want to do is maintain that and sustain it. And they should be recognised for the value that they put into that and rewarded for that. But they would get that reward from perhaps the more direct target schemes.
OK, thank you. Just very briefly, we've heard from many of the environmental NGOs that the proposed tiers are round the wrong way and we shouldn't see 50% of payments guaranteed and ring-fenced with conditionality in Tier 1. Do you subscribe to the argument that we should see more funding in Tier 3 and 4? That's probably the question.
It all comes down to how much conditionality we can build into all four tiers. So if it's clear, readily achievable conditions within Tier 1 and Tier 2 that will deliver that broad management, then there doesn't need to be a huge amount of distribution. But if we can't get that into Tier 1, Tier 2, then yeah, we need to make sure that Tier 3 and Tier 4 are adequately funded in order to deliver the targets.
OK, thank you. Rachel, do you have a supplementary?
No, not
at the moment. OK.
I don't.
Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. And I want to thank you both this morning. It's been fascinating. In particular, I'm really interested in what's happening in the Northeast. That's where my constituency is. We've seen in Berkshire and Buchan Coast the real effects actually of climate change really being at the forefront of a lot of storm damage, flooding and coastal erosion, compounded really with the bird flu epidemic we've had as well. We're seeing masses of loss of our coastal birds, Troophead in particular, where we could be seeing this devastation, lingering on for decades to come because of what has really happened there. But at the same time, the perception is that we're kind of overrun with gulls because they do make themselves a bit of a nuisance with the locals. So I'm in a situation here where we're trying to build knowledge around the change in environment in the Northeast, the impacts that we have, on our climate, the impacts that have on our wildlife and our biodiversity. And talking to farmers, as you alluded to earlier, they see these changes, they know and understand what's going on and are quite keen, to help as rapidly as they possibly can, trying to encourage more clover growth, for example. And, they're concerned about the lack of butterflies, saying that there hasn't been as much butterflies as they would normally see. So there is this whole rapid change in landscape, but also maybe not so much public awareness of what's going on. And I'm just wondering, in light of COP15 and the Scottish Government's biodiversity strategy, what good is coming from that? What can we see? What does that mean for the future agricultural policy? And how can we almost energise people, and educate people to get on board with what's happening?
What a great way of putting it, if I may comment on that. Problem is that whilst people recognise that we have a climate emergency for the very reasons you've been describing, don't think people get that we have a nature emergency as well. I mean, there's a growing realisation of it, but we've got a very long way to go. What you're describing for gulls, for instance, what's happened with gulls is a catastrophe, but it's because of what's happened at sea. I mean, the food base for gulls has just been, it's declined for a great many reasons, and so gulls are having to move inland. So they're moving into towns and cities, not adapted to breeding, to the extent that now herring gulls and lesser blackback gulls on a daily basis are very good at tracking school children and knowing where there'll be ready food for them. Now, we're very fortunate we have very good guidance available both within Nature Scot and within the local authorities on how we should be managing and controlling gull populations. But that broader realisation of climate change contributing to the nature crisis and therefore to the problems we have on our doorstep really is a parable for what's happening more widely. And you know, to come back to farmers, that's why farmers, probably more than any other enterprise, land use in Scotland, get it, because they're witnessing these changes and understanding the changes that are taking place. And so if only we can get that wider realisation across schools and wider communities as to what's causing this sort of conjoined nature and climate crisis, and therefore the measures we need to put in place in order to tackle it. So, you know, for gulls, that's such a good example. Don't blame gulls. Gulls, what we see with gulls is just the symptom of decades of change resulting in these massive changes and redistributions in nature.
Thank you.
We've touched on whole farm plans and whatever, but we know Nature Scotland involved in developing a natural capital assessment template, and there was high hopes that that would deliver, and it would maybe give us an indication of baselines and you know, touching on the previous questions I've asked. Can I ask you how the assessment template is progressing and whether you're still as confident it will look promising as a useful tool when it comes to whole farm planning?
So we've got it to a stage where we're trying to simplify the natural capital approach, which is an internationally recognised theory about how you assess multiple public outcomes and how you use that to inform decision making. And so we've adapted that process to a farming context within Scotland, and we've tested it out with about 40 farmers and crofters, mostly to try and find out whether they can grasp the concept and whether they can use it effectively in their own farm situation. So as for those that are not familiar with the National Gov process, it doesn't just take a look at biodiversity. It looks at the production of the farm is, what the labour force is, what the soil conditions are, and it find a way of putting them side by side and saying what gives and what are the trade-offs for that particular farm, that location, in terms of how the farmer maximises the natural capital within the farm. So it's more than biodiversity, it embraces carbon audits. It effectively could be a form of whole farm planning, is where we've got it to. But what it does depend on is that discussion we've had earlier about good data as to the condition of down to the sort of field level, which is lacking in some places. So the level of data is good in some farms and not so good in other farms, in terms of publicly available, free-to-use data. So take it to the next stage, we need to develop that database as a starting point, so farmers find it easier to understand through the natural capital tool, what they've got and what conditions they're at. But we also need to discuss with Scottish Government colleagues as to whether it would form the basis, or it could form the basis, or inform a whole farm planning approach in terms of Tier 1.
Thank you, Ross. Jenny Minto.
Thank you. I'm interested if you've got any preliminary findings from the pilots on outcome-based approaches and whether they are helping influence the payment model, and also what connections you've got with other projects that are going on, like the Monitor Farms through Quality Meat Scotland, and then also Nature Friendly Farming Network are also doing peer-to-peer support and looking at the way that things should change.
Yeah, so we've tested an outcome-based approach with about 80
to 100,000 crofters over the last 3 years, largely in a kind of theoretical basis as to if you were to be supported on an outcomes basis as opposed to a prescriptive basis, which is how farm support has happened up to now, how would that work for you as a farmer and crofter, and what's your understanding of the outcomes in your circumstances? And overwhelmingly, responses, farmers respond to that far better than having a prescriptive top-down layer. Pray out this measure in this way, otherwise we won't pay you or we get penalised. So that's a fundamental lesson we've learned from that. But then, of course, what is an outcome? And what we've managed to come up with is a series of outcomes that actually are quite similar according to farm type and the type of habitat you're talking about. So, for instance, we've used a scorecard approach, which we've used from other examples, particularly in Ireland, Southern Ireland, elsewhere in Europe, where it's been tested, where we set out, well, how do you know what the outcome is and how would you get there? Using a number of simple-to-use parameters that a farmer, and this is what we've largely been testing, could understand and see in the field themselves and score. So it's a kind of scorecard approach on a kind of 1 to 10 scale. And, well, that's what it comes out with. And that is probably the biggest element that we've learned in terms of effectively what would happen is a farmer and their advisor, Scottish Government official running the schemes, can use that as a basis to say, take a hedgerow, for instance, or a species-rich grassland and say, okay, let's use a scorecard to score where you're at. If you're a number 4 on a scale of 10, then you could progress up 5 and 6 by adopting a number of measures to prove it in your context. And that effectively, you would draw down your payment to do that regardless. And it would be a different measure for somebody in the west of Scotland or Gael, and it would be somebody in Ireland. But the outcome is the same. So that's how we think the outcome approach can work better in terms of how payments are constructed and work. And the payment would be the same whether you're in Aberdeen or in Argyll, but the way the outcome is achieved would be different. An example of that would be dates. So we have, in the EEC scheme, for instance, wader measures, where farmers are expected to shut off their field in springtime to allow waders to breed and nest. And there's a standard set date has been in the EEC scheme for that. But, of course, that date changes according to where you are in Scotland. Mm-hmm. And the prescriptive, audited way that we deliver the scheme is made difficult to make that variable. But if you take an outcome approach, then the farmer can decide when they shut the field off according to the wader's behaviour in their particular location, but still receive the payment.
OK, and have you been linking into the Monitor Farms or the Nature Friendly Farming Network?
Yes, so in the steering, we have a steering group for that project, which involves Nature Friendly Farming Network and NFUS and others on the group. We are starting to engage with the Quality Meat Scotland Monitor Farm system because they themselves, the farmer clusters that they're just setting up just now, are asking for understanding about how they and their location. Leicestershire and North Scotland and so on, and including one in Isle as well, who are saying, well, we want to know what we can do for biodiversity in our location. So we're looking to share the tools and the scorecards that we've been using and testing with our 80 farmers, with those monitor farmer groups, to say, you go test them in your situation. Do they work for you? And what particular groups' outcomes are you achieving in your area?
OK, thank you.
Alistair Allen.
Convener. I'm interested to know how either of you might want to respond to the CivTech challenges. And I'm looking at challenge 8.2, how can technology help drive effective resource management for a multi-skilled workforce in a constantly changing environment, which seems to relate to rural payments and inspectorate division, if I'm right. I wonder if you can respond to that, or more generally to the CivTech challenges and how they might be applied in developing agriculture policy for the future.
Well, we've engaged with it. In fact, it was the CivTech challenge that's kicked us off in developing the outcome-based approach. So the POBAS project, that we call it, Palatine Outcome-Based Approach in Scotland, was partly funded by the CivTech process to come up with an app-based basis for doing this scoring exercise I just explained. And we worked with a new startup technology company based in Edinburgh to develop the application process. They are now taking their products, looking to get support for it, not just within public sector, but into the private sector, into supermarkets and so on. So what we, whether or not we use what they've developed in terms of helping support future payment distribution, they themselves are looking to use it as a tool to sell to farmers and to supermarkets and others to say, this is how you can, a supermarket, for instance, could set premium on biodiversity delivery using the app that they've developed.
Okay.
And there are a number of other examples that are being developed in that similar vein.
Thank you. Just before we move on to the next question, we're probably going to be running over a little bit. Are you, a gentleman, still available for a period after 11:30? That would be helpful.
Yes.
Thank you. We'll move on to a question from Rachel Hamilton.
Well, first of all, I'm going to ask you a broad question. What is the difference between a catchment management and a landscape scale approach? I go to Ross.
It's two different ways of explaining what a landscape might be. So, yeah, at the moment, there are different ways you could argue what we mean by landscape. We can articulate through kind of biogeographical terms of a glen, which, with a river in the middle, which is the catchment leading down to the shoreline, or it could be a cluster of farms on a particular soil type and land type that all have a very similar type of farming activity, or it could be a group of hills, and so on. So it's in many ways, rather than be, it's organic in terms of how it's defined. Generally, our understanding about the most effective landscape scale partnerships, I suppose you want to call it, are generated organically by the fact that there's a logical number of individuals who come together before it becomes unwieldy. It tends to be somewhere between 10, 50,000 hectare type scale area of land, which makes sense in terms of the similar geographical characteristics.
That's really helpful, thank you. And I won't get the opportunity, but I just want to say this has been a really, really useful session. So I understand the approach is very similar, and it brings together urban, rural, industry, tourism, and it has, you prioritise your goals, whether it's water quality, wildlife, and it basically looks at the land use strategy. So, bearing in mind what we have talked about in this session with regards to the regional approach, what work have you been doing that could help create a future agricultural payment scheme? And how do you envisage all of those stakeholders who are trying to reach the same goal being part of that payment scheme? I'll go to Des Thompson, please.
Yeah, no, thank you. So, one sort of difference between the catchment and the landscape approach, and you'll see where I'm going here, is that for the catchment approach, we're really going from summit to sea. So from the highest areas, thinking about a mountain area, down to the sea, at each step, putting in place measures that benefit biodiversity. So it might be peatland restoration through our Peatland Action Programme high up, creation of riparian woodland, along river margins, helping to mitigate effects of climate change, benefiting salmon and other fish species, working your way down to the sea where we're into sort of flood risk reduction. Working at that catchment level, if we can incentivise the land users and the communities to come together, you're going to get a disproportionately greater benefit for biodiversity rather than adopting just a piecemeal approach. So for your riparian woodland, for instance, so massively important in terms of enriching water quality and benefiting biodiversity around there. Unless you have sufficient deer management, you would have to put in place expensive fencing, which is not sustainable. So again, it's adopting that holistic approach and ensuring that the resources cover all the land uses that are affecting that sort of management you're putting in place from summit to sea, or as Scottish Water refer to its source to tap.
I can add to that if that's...
Yes, come in, Ross, please.
So, I mean, you may be referring to regional land use partnerships and potentially that approach to how we might prioritise land use. There's no doubt about it. We need to, because this... So agricultural support, important that it is, particularly the farming sector, it's only one part of the metric that was needed, or the support that's going to be needed to bring land use change for climate and for biodiversity. We know that we're talking about 20 billion potentially required to get nature where we need it to be within the next 10, 20 years, in 10 years or so. That's not going to come from the public sector. It's not going to come from the agriculture budget, which is currently about $500 million a year in Scotland under the cap regime. So we're going to have to lever in the private investment into land use. And, you know, farmers can be part of that as well. And you know, I'm not just talking about land purchase for nature. I'm not talking about carbon codes necessarily. I'm talking about quite big... private investment in capital investment in land use change. So, for instance, the issue around flood management, for instance, there's models there where private sector would perhaps invest in flood management across fields upstream in order to prevent flood damage downstream and so on. It doesn't need to come from the public sector. It can come through natural capital markets in a tradable format that brings a good income support to the farmer, as well as the capital measures required to do it. And what we need to make sure is that public support the farmer gets through farm support schemes dovetails with that. It helps that happen rather than goes against it. And I think what's happening at the moment is farmers are naturally holding off from engaging in that private market investment at landscape scale because they don't know how they're going to get supported through farm support.
That's exactly how I envisaged the answer that you were going to give, because I loved the description of dovetailing the agricultural payments alongside all the other things that are happening. So if I use my own constituency as an example, the Hoyt Flood Risk Management Scheme was only funded to a certain point. Now, anyone, residents living beyond that, still get their houses flooded.
Yeah.
And it isn't bringing the whole community within that project. But if it had been the TV to the summit, it was confined by resource, unfortunately. And that is exactly, I think, what you've just described. So it has to be a whole load of things, such as MPF4, planning applications, investment on flood risk management and the agricultural payment system.
And if I could say that natural capital tool that we mentioned earlier was about a farmer having using the natural capital process for their own farm management interests, what Nature Scotland is testing just now is building a tool that works at landscape scale. So it's a tool. We're not sort of dictating what should happen at landscape scale. We're providing a means for a partnership of multi-land users, farmers being a major part of it, but Scottish Water, deeper local authorities, other landowners, foresters and so on, would use that tool collectively to work out where the priorities are for that regional scale.
Okay.
We've sort of got that already with the biosphere. So we've got the biosphere in Galloway in Southern Ayrshire that covers over 5,500 square kilometres, but it's got no powers. It did get £1.7 million worth of funding, but there is a model there that may be an exemplar when it comes to the landscape or catchment area tight management. And what's missing is the link, as Rachel said, the link between commercial, between agriculture and whatever. And that's maybe, so we do have a model there to some extent to deliver some of these policies. Jim Fairley's got a supplementary on what we've been talking about then. Jenny Minto.
Thanks very much, Convener. Ross, I'm just going to come back to what you were talking about there, that dovetailing. And I, like Rachel, I like that analogy. But we've heard from Martin Kennedy last week that we have to remember that the bill that we're actually scrutinising, which you're talking to today, is an agricultural bill, therefore to support agriculture, to produce food and to be create resilience in the food system. Does it currently look to you as though we're trying to do too much with one bill with a limited pot of money?
At the moment, the way that the CAP payments are split is largely Pillar 1, which is food production farming can support, and Pillar 2, which is where a lot of the wider public goods that we're talking about has been delivered so far, and the split of funding is appropriately. Yes, the agriculture budget, well, the intention of it should continue to support that broader public goods, that services that we get from farmers and pay them the services they produce. We shouldn't lose that. I suppose the question is how much of that, in the way that farmers are producing food, can also deliver on the wider public benefits is the critical question. And what we are advising and we're suggesting is there's good examples out there, both in farmers that are operating today and in the science and the evidence out there, that farmers can produce food for that part of the support in a way that, A, is make sure it continues to be resilient and sustainable, given the climate shocks that are coming right now, and B, can actually deliver way more from the biodiversity and wider public interest than has been able to up to now because of the way they've been supported up to now.
Yeah, okay. So the farming community absolutely accept that they've got a massive role to play in this. Nobody denies that. But given the scale of the challenges that we have, all the things that the farming community will do within the confines of the funding that will be available to them, it seems to me that it's not going to be nearly enough. And you talked about private equity coming into the landscape style gains that we have to make. Is there a need to shift some of the focus away from the funding that's in agriculture to look at how we're going to do it on a much bigger scale?
Yeah, absolutely. But to meet the nature targets, to meet the climate targets, it needs more than what public money is currently available or like to be available. So that the private sector, who wants to pay for this, whether it's the supermarket who's prepared to put premium in, the customer who's prepared to pay that premium on food that's produced in a more sustainable, environmentally sensible way, or it's the financial sector, private sector, who wants to pay for natural capital goods, currently in the kind of carbon markets, but there's lots of work going on just now in understanding what the additional benefits are from just carbon, but nature targets as well. There's that investment sitting there. Directly for farming, for regenerative agriculture, for instance, the banks, for instance, would start to get interested in terms of just to make sure that their investments in farming are more sustainable and resilient. And by supporting that type of farming.
Given that you've just mentioned supermarkets and whether they put a premium on this type of food, we've been down this road before, and generally these things get brought in as incentives and then become sticks to beat you with at a later date. So given the fact also that we're in a cost of living crisis right now, people will not be able to afford to pay that premium. So that funding is going to have to come from different sources, isn't it?
Well, I think some of the key habitats that we need for biodiversity and for climate, such as woodland, peatland restoration, hedgerows, for instance, organic soils, the carbon in those and the nature benefits on top of that carbon, in the way they're managed, there's a value there that the financial sector are prepared to invest in.
Yeah, but that then leads to that. That then leads to that danger of Scotland losing its natural. Sorry, I cut across you there. I do apologise. That then leads to Scotland being in danger of losing the value of its natural capital to big organisations who are not actually living here. That may be a bigger question than what you're here to actually think about. It's just, sorry, the process is going through my mind as we speak.
Well obviously, the farmer can receive an income from that in a way that they've not had been able to up to now.
OK, thank you.
Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener. And can I just echo what other members have said about this being a really interesting and informative session? We spoke earlier about knowledge gaps and Ross mentioned digital data, but when looking at improving biodiversity on farmland, what are your key research and development areas? And how do you envisage that evidence generated through ongoing research will feed into the agriculture policy of the Scottish Government?
Well, Desmond, can we come to you? Yeah. What we're seeing is that there's five actions that all farmers can take for nature. Number one is make sure that they're planning and integrating what they're doing in a whole farm approach and the landscape approach we discussed. Number two is soil. So if there's one take-home message for what we want to do with agriculture support and farming is improve our soil health, because it just generates so much outcomes across the public agenda, not just resilient food production, obviously the climate agenda in terms of reducing emissions from soils and sequestering carbon for that matter, and then biodiversity. We haven't mentioned so far today that half our biodiversity is actually below the soil surface, not above it. So that's two. Number three is enhancing the habitat network, so creating space for nature, providing those field margins, those hedgerows, those pieces of woodlands, those species-rich grasslands, unimproved grasslands, and linking them up across the farm, number three. Number four is creating new habitats so we get that scale. And number five is specific species targets, the sort of things that Des has mentioned that we can take. They're all very easy to implement and measure. And I suppose it goes back to we just need to make sure that we get enough of it happening at scale and we are able to know when it's happening, and that's where that data thing comes in. We've got a database that is truly national that allows us to be updated regularly enough to know that those five elements are actually happening.
What was the number?
Okay.
And just if I may just to come in on that, I absolutely agree with Ross about his number two on soils. We're learning so much about the soils. Brilliant work at the James Hutton Institute. We're finding species new to science being found in the equivalent of a teaspoonful of soil, in particular some of our mountain and woodland soils. And the sort of composition of fungi in particular within the soils is so important in terms of influencing carbon sequestration. And if only we could communicate more to farmers and other land users about the importance of soils and soil condition, I think that would make a world of difference, because people are fascinated by soils and really understand the importance of soils, not just for sustaining biodiversity and food, of course, but also in terms of sequestering carbon.
That's fine. Yep, Jenny Minto. Have you a supplementary on this? No.
No, I don't have a supplementary, but I was agreeing there because I remember being at a meeting where a farmer spoke very passionately. He's based on Lismore, and he had been in the 1970s how to increase crops, specifically strawberries, and he said the smell when he put the chemicals on the field, he should have realised he was killing things. So I was just nodding in agreement that I'm not entirely clear why you've come to me.
No, I
so apologies for that, going off on a tangent.
I'm mixing up my GMs and my GFs.
Oh, right, I see.
My apologies. When it comes to soil, there is one area of contention at the moment, and it does have an implication when it comes to Nature Scott as well. So improving soil is really important, and one of the reasons we do it, one of the ways we can do that is increase decrease the input of nitrogen fertilisers, reduce the use of pesticides, whatever. But
to maintain our output, we've got to improve how crops fix nitrogen, for example, or are able to uptake and use the nutrients that are in the soil more effectively. Because if not, we'd see a drop-off in yield. What's your views on the use of GE, so genetic modification of potatoes or cereals or grass, to ensure that it can uptake the available nutrients in the soil far more effectively than currently? Is that something you think should be in the mix?
I suppose there's a different question there around the unknown consequences of genetically modified crops on nature, which is something that would concern us. If we're going to introduce genetically modified crops, do we have enough science and evidence as to what the likely impacts are on nature that we unforeseen? But separately, maybe not necessarily sidestep your question. Whatever crop you're putting in the soil, what we're saying is if it requires a lot of extractive additional and inorganic inputs to achieve it, and treating the soil as a substrate, then that's not the direction that we need to go in if we're going to have our soils are resilient from the point of view of food production and from the point of view of climate and nature. So we need to have crops that are able to make the most of the organic matter in the soil's ability to provide the nutrient content. And whether that's genetically modified or otherwise, that's the fundamental question.
Yeah, the likes of the Hutton Institute would suggest that there's huge advances in technology that we can use to apply to crops that would reduce their impact on the natural environment. Yes, certainly go.
Let's diversify the cropping system so that because the more diverse crops are, the more likely it's going to soil improvement will happen. Let's bring legumes into the system. Livestock have to be part of it. If we're using agricultural regenerative systems as part of cropping, because they produce a lot of the organic matter. And then at the bottom of the tree is the use of inorganic inputs. They're going to have to continue to be there, obviously, in order to maintain productivity for at least whilst we're transitioning to our agricultural system. But let's minimise them, and therefore there's good technology to try and target them better so that they have least impact on the wider nature.
Great. Thanks. Jim Fairley.
This is a wee sup to this section, if that's okay, convener.
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. you talked about the research in soil, and sorry, as I'm talking to you on this one, you talked about the research in soil, mm-hmm. And I'm going to find out more of some of the stuff that you've been looking at. And again, I'm going to irritate my colleagues. This has been a fascinating session. Farmers will take up whatever we ask them to do if they believe in it and they trust it. What we're hearing a lot from the farming community just now is the different science being thrown at them with different requirements. How do we get a set of scientific data that they can put their trust in and buy into so that we actually achieve the outcomes of this?
So we're very... Ross, sorry. I mean, just taking carbon audits from point of view, there are a number of carbon tools, auditing tools around. And in Scotland, as I understand it, the majority of farmers are using agriculture provided SRUC. I mean, I think this is something for the industry to really lead on, and that ultimately it's the use of these tools has helped the industry understand its performance and improve its performance as a whole. And I think it's something that they can support individuals, farmers, sharing the results that they're getting from use of the tools, then rationalising the metrics that the tools are using so that it's equivalent to how technology is developed in other spheres, like video technology, for instance. Ultimately, a single metric, commonly used metric, will emerge. I don't think we can probably easily build a metric that everyone and insist on everybody use a single metric. It needs to come from the bottom up and sharing that data and understanding where their variables are. But there is an important challenge there in terms of developing a series of biodiversity metrics that everyone signs up to, and therefore more people have confidence in. And the Scottish Government have committed to having a Centre for Biodiversity Expertise, and there's some early planning around that. And I think that will be a very important focal point for providing the evidence base on biodiversity change and the drivers and what you need to do to get the best for biodiversity. I think people would have a lot of confidence in that. And we are fortunate, very fortunate in Scotland, in that so many research centres work together. We have terrific collaboration across Scotland of centres such as the SRUC, James Hutton Institute, UHI, and some of the mainstream university departments. And that's something we need to build on. And we have great expertise within Scottish Government itself, within RESAS, for instance.
OK, thank you, Convener.
A very brief supplementary from Rachel Hamilton.
Can you talk about sort of making it streamlined in terms of the what we're using to look at farm outputs, agricultural outputs. We were with the group of people who created the report 1.5 degrees farming, I think it was called, last night. Yeah. And I asked the question about whether we should be calculating methane emissions by GWP 100 or GWP star. And there was a kind of overwhelming consensus that we should be ensuring that methane is calculated with one calculation rather than both of these because it is skewing the data. What is your opinion on that?
I think there is an issue that the way the IPCC measure emissions and set emission targets does tend to confuse the ask from individual farmers, in that, so for instance, it's the net emissions that they're dealing with rather than the total emissions that coming from land. And I suppose that the difference between the two metrics on methane is an example of that. And I don't really know, apart from other than what we mustn't do is let these fusions stop people starting to take action. I suppose over time, as the science gets better and understanding how those particular targets are measured, it will come a bit apparent that one's better than the other. But at the moment, let's just get farmers looking at ways in that they can reduce methane emissions from animals and not too worry about which target they're hitting. And not to worry about the fact that what we have to recognise is any effort farmers are making to reduce emissions that are not recognised by the IPCC's targets are not they are recognised in the way they get supported for that. You know what I mean? Mm. The effort they put into is supported by the agriculture support system. Rather than the measures against the IPCC targets.
Thank you very much. It's been a fantastic session, and which I can expect, given that Ross is a former Aberdeen Agri colleague of mine, I would expect nothing less. Thank you very much, Des and Ross. It's been a great session. Thank you for your time this morning and giving us a little bit extra time for our questions. That concludes our meeting in public, and we now move into private session, and I suspend the meeting for a 5-minute comfort break.